America, 2-1 victors over England last night. Ruth Fahy joins us to give us her analysis of the game. Ruth, good morning to you. How are you doing?
Good morning, guys. How are you doing? Did you get to see the game last night?
Yeah, totally. I was pretty engrossed by it. We were chatting yesterday about who we were going to be up for. I was on Team USA all the way. Owen, I don't know what happened to him. He forgot the 800 years and was cheering for the Lionesses. So who are you up for?
Yeah, I was a bit on Owen's side and I kind of forgot that last 800 years or so because I don't know, I thought USA were going to do it, but I really wanted England to do it. And mostly because the fact that there's a lot of our Irish girls actually play kind of on a daily basis with some of the English girls. And I just thought the idea that they could, you know, play and train with them at club level and they can go on to that level to win the World Cup was a nice kind of reflection, I suppose, for Irish football more than anything. So it wasn't, you know, the 800 years obviously was a big factor, but I was keeping that in mind too.
How would we have done it this World Cup? Watching the style and the quality of football that we saw last night, how far away are we from that standard at the minute, Ruth?
How far are Ireland away?
Yeah.
Yeah, interesting question, because that was very much in my mind, especially as I watched the group stages. And when you're watching, I suppose, England, USA, you know, the Dutch, Norway, we've seen they're a step ahead in terms of quality, but watching the likes of Italy, the likes of Spain, and these are teams that Ireland would have played recently and probably lost marginally. I think it was scored, I think, 2-1, 1-0. You're kind of looking at those games and you're thinking, yeah, the gap isn't too big there. And the fact that, you know, Italy went on and got to the quarterfinals, Spain obviously put it up to USA in the last 16 as well. It's very difficult to know until you're there. I suppose that's it's so difficult to know. But the gap with that lower tier is not that big. But yeah, the likes of USA England last night, obviously there's a good bit of distance away till we can see Ireland in that kind of scene. But again, it's not unfathomable now at this stage.
Because obviously the Euros are in England next time. It's a big opportunity for most of our team who are playing in England to have, you know, playing grounds they're familiar with, and for a big Irish crowd to show up and support the team, which means the next 18 months of qualifying is unbelievably important.
Exactly. Like, it's all kind of coming to this point, isn't it, really? And as you say, the fact that the Euros, which is probably something Colin Bell, I know, and I'm sure we'll talk about him too, I know he would have targeted this coming campaign as the one. Obviously, you know, we'll say Ireland ran Norway and Ireland close. They didn't really, in the end, the campaign kind of got away from Ireland in the end for the World Cup. But the Euros is a different story. I think it's a loss. Like, honestly, genuinely so realistic. I think not to get to the next Euros will probably be seen as quite a failure from our side, just considering everything that's happened in Irish women's football, you know, in the last 2 years, going back to 2017 and that protest and the strike and all the stories that came out. A lot has improved, a lot has changed. I think the World Cup campaign came too close to that, but I think the Euros certainly didn't. And obviously, we have an interesting couple of weeks ahead. I think that the Ireland senior manager job is going to be advertised externally as well. So, you know, who knows what kind of candidates are going to apply for that. Hopefully the calibre is really high. I'd love to see it go to somebody, obviously, outside the general norm. But we have this really interesting scenario where it's kind of like the Irish men's job. We have this campaign and this major tournament looming that we really, like, we have to qualify for. But at the same time, you really want someone to come in who's Irish and who's going to look at the Women's National League and try and look at that long term and make it better, because that's what needs to be done, and that's probably where Colin Bell would have fallen a bit short.
Yeah, because it was interesting. Colin Bell, the announcement came, there was a little bit of talk about it. Generally, it was like, oh, he did an okay job. But then talking to Anya Gorman yesterday, she was like, he did an all right job. It wasn't amazing. Like, you know, it wasn't,
yeah.
We didn't qualify. He didn't do any better than any of the previous managers, which is, you know, it's interesting to hear that. And we kind of need to start hearing that level of what's actually happening in Irish women's football coming out, where people are saying, hang on a second, what is our expectation here and what are our standards? You're saying we have to qualify and that's what we should be expecting. With all of the good teams that we've had over the last half decade at underage level, they're all coming to senior level at this point. So it's right that we should be expecting our teams to qualify, and it's right when our players are playing with the majority of those English players that they see themselves equal to those guys.
Yeah, absolutely. I hit the nail on the head there, and you're right, I'm glad you cited on his interview, because I thought that was brilliant. I thought it was really important that she came out and said those kind of things. You know, she's the best type of person to to give a view on Colin Bell, it's the players that have played under him. When I heard the news that he was leaving, I was like, initially, I was just hit because I had spoken to Colin a couple of weeks back. I'd gone to a Bundesliga game to watch a friend of mine play for Duisburg. I met him there. He was, you know, he was there watching, which again is another great reflection upon him. He would have gone to all the games. He did bring things forward. He did things that previous managers wouldn't have done, things that previous managers should have done that was the norm to him. But I met him there, and he was just so excited, just so looking forward to next campaign, but just so certain as well that this was the time. And, you know, I've spoken to him before about other campaigns, but he was really, really sure that this was it, and he was kind of instilling that confidence in me as well. And then when the news came, it just came, for me, it came out completely out of nowhere. What had happened was I'd heard things before where he'd had offers and turned them down because he was so committed to the campaign. So I think I was a bit naive in my initial reaction. I just thought, no, there must be something wrong here. But, you know, as things transpired and obviously the FAI released their statement, it just appears as if he had a decent offer and he couldn't turn it down. He was trying to negotiate a way, in fairness to him, that he could stay and still keep a role, but he just couldn't turn this offer down. And that's disappointing for me because I want someone in there completely committed to the cause. And that's because I'm emotionally invested in this team. You know, it's totally different from that sense. But as you say, like Anya said, she cited that the results were okay. They were okay. When we think back about Colin Bell's tenure, we'll think immediately to that nil-all draw away from the Netherlands where he pulled off something, I suppose, that a manager hadn't done before. And that's what stood out for it. But then as that campaign went on, I think he kind of hit gold when he brought Tyler Tolan through, out of the youngest player at 16. And then he tried himself to replicate that again and again. And it kind of didn't go right from at certain stages. He brought a lot of young players into the squad. I know he had players training here, you know, 15 years old. I know that didn't sit well with all of the players. It worked for some young players. Some are ready, some aren't. I know you can, you know, blood players with experience, but he was kind of doing that probably a little bit too much, and again, losing the likes of Anya. I think losing the likes of Karen Duggan, for me, that was absolutely crucial because Karen Duggan's so key in that squad, and she has years to give, and there are other players there too. So, yeah, it's good to hear those kind of things coming in, and I suppose that lessens the pain of the fact that we've lost, you know, someone really instrumental. You can't take that away from him at this really crucial point going forward, and like I say, it's going to be... I can't wait to see who's going to come in.
Yeah, so just
I'm
on that,
really excited about it, yeah.
On that route, like, does it need to be somebody who is completely au fait with the current playing setup, or could it be somebody in the mould of what England have done, like Phil Neville, who obviously has their coaching badges, but, you know, so, like, in the Ireland coaching field at the minute, somebody like Brian Kerr, for example, would that be something that women's football in Ireland would welcome?
Yes, 100%. I think the whole community of women's football is really open to something like that. Someone put forward the name of Roy Keane. I just, like, you know, that would be the dream. I don't think Roy would be too tempted, to be fair to him, but like something along those lines instead of Brian Kerr, like what Neville has done in England. I think it would be great to have someone Irish come in. I'm not sure how the FAI will feel about that. But, and again, and for me, it doesn't have to be someone with big tournament experience. Yes, the next campaign is so, so crucial. But for me, I'm coming from, you know, that Irish football overlooking kind of view. And I want someone to come in and really, really focus on our National League because it's falling apart. And, you know, everybody knows that. I prefer not to, you know, just react really quickly, bring someone in. I prefer them to come in, take their time, and look ahead to the next 5 years, 10 years, if that's possible. I know that's not always possible when you're recruiting a manager with a big campaign looming.
Like someone like Roy Keane, as you mentioned there, would be perfect given the on a purely philosophical level. I mean, what Ger was talking about earlier on, the expectation. Like Roy Keane goes in there and he's like, we expect to qualify for things, we expect to win. Anything other than the very best out of this team just simply is not good enough. And that's the expectation that he would bring, and that's the sort of expectation, as you've already mentioned, that is required.
Yeah. The Roy Keane thing makes me laugh. I met Roy about 2 years ago. I think I got slightly starstruck and I kind of panicked and said, what do you think of women's football? And he kind of just looked at me and I said, oh, what do you think? And he kind of referred back to a game he'd seen and he went to watch the Irish women's team 2 years previously. He said, oh, yeah, what's that? What's that? And then he stopped and he laughed and said, look, I've got, is it 3 or 4 daughters he has? I can't even remember. He said, I can't even comment on this. He's like, it's great. great. But in terms of knowledge, I don't think, and I'm not sure if Roy Keane is going to come in and lift Irish women's football. But someone like that, yes, as you say, to have the expectation of winning. But see, that's what Colin Bell has. He had such a high level of professionalism, probably that the previous regime didn't have. He changed a lot of things. A lot of habits were different. He was very strict. I know that. I think it was difficult for some of the girls to move over into that kind of regime. But that's what he did. And I think that's really, really important to bring in that expectation. But they have that now. You know, that's the legacy that Colin Bell has left as well. He made them want to win, believe in themselves. No one's going to come in and go backwards, I assume. You know, kind of way. So,
no, exactly.
And then I just don't know.
Exactly. And look, it just feels like there's a moment in time here where there is an FAI administration who are looking for an opportunity to point to some good stuff that's coming down the tracks. And it's clear that an investment in women's football is the right thing to do for all sorts of reasons, not just commercial reasons, not just because it's actually what they're supposed to be doing, but also because there's a public groundswell of support. People are watching these games in a way that we haven't really seen before. Like, the World Cup was on last night, everybody's watching it like a World Cup game. It's not that it's a women's World Cup game, it's a World Cup game. And so if you were in the FAI at the minute and you were looking for something to hang your hat on, a good quality, high profile appointment for the vacant position, backed up with a plan to help the Women's National League, like, it's a fairly straightforward win for everybody.
Yeah, exactly. It is. It's completely straightforward. This is the perfect time, as you say. And while it's so crushing for Colin to leave, just because he has that momentum, he's put in all the groundwork, and I think everything he had been building towards in the previous couple of years was looking at this campaign, and that's why it's really tough. But this is huge. As you say, every single person, like everybody I know, the amount of texts I was getting last night about the USA English game, I'm talking from friends who have not even no interest in football, but no interest in sport, because that's what a World Cup does. It gets you to the screen and gets you to watch it. Everybody is watching. And I'm trying to just, you know, to be fair, there are a couple of names out there as well, and names that I would certainly not disagree with. We have the likes of Eileen Gleeson, that name's been thrown up, and I love that, because she knows the game in Ireland so, so well. Other people will say she doesn't have, you know, that international experience. That doesn't matter. She's a hugely highly qualified coach, and she knows all the girls inside out. She knows, like, the landscape of women's football, and she knows the trials and tribulations that it's been through as well. And she's someone that can go in and fix that, because she has that experience. On the same tune, to bring in someone, you know, completely externally from abroad to come in, looking at this campaign in particular, and bringing that sort of international experience, that wouldn't be a bad thing either. But I think at this time, you have to look beyond. Like, for me, altering the landscape of women's football in Ireland is more important than, you know, a shotgun approach as well. But I think if they can strike the balance there, they'll be striking gold.
Ruth, great stuff. Thanks a million for joining us this morning.
Thanks, guys. Enjoy the game tonight, and chat to you soon.
It's Ruth Fahy there, giving us some thoughts on what's going on generally. We obviously talked about the game a little bit earlier on, if you missed that.
Mm-hmm. It's interesting that she says that. I mean, that's the very sort of thing that seems to be the hallmark of this United States team, the expectation that they have. Like, the arrogance and the sort of brash nature of them is one part of it, but the other part of it is, we are the best in the world, and we are going to win this World Cup, and we are going to crush you.
And that goes
to
tradition and investment that, you know, Title IX invested the equal amount of money in women's sport as men's sport, and soccer was the primary benefit of that at university level, 30, 40 years of players and coaching coming through. So there's a backbone there. Anyway, let's move on.